So great to see some new faces and then faces I haven't seen for a while. My name is Carrie Carnahan. I'm the assistant director of UConn's Creative Writing Program. I work for Mr. Sean Forbes, who some of you know. And Sean and Lauren have worked very hard to put together this event, so I'm so happy you're all here to welcome Tara Betts. So I'm just going to say a few words about the Aetna Writer-in-Residence Program and also another one of the occasions tonight, and then I'll introduce Tara. So the Aetna Writer-in-Residence Program began in 2003. Supported by funding from the Aetna Chair in Writing, UConn's Creative Writing Program invites a nationally or internationally known author to campus for a residency each semester. Each author spends 3 days on campus offering tutorials for students, holding Q&A sessions with the campus community, leading master classes in creative writing, sharing meals with students, and giving a public reading of his or her work. As a result of the Aetna Writer in Residence Program, UConn graduate and undergraduate students can participate in an intense hands-on learning experience with some of today's most exciting authors. And I can vouch for this program because I got a chance to work with Eduardo Corral, who some of you might know. It was really, really great. So in addition to Tara, some other past writers who some of you might know who came as a courtesy of the Aetna program include Jeff Parker, who was just here, was it last week? 2 weeks ago. Semesters, my. Kimiko Han, Amber Dumont, Jericho Brown, Laura Vandenberg, and Camille Benji. Wonderful poets, wonderful writers. So tonight's event is also a benefit reading to support the Covenant Soup Kitchen in Willimantic. Is there someone from the Soup Kitchen here tonight? Okay, so no one is here from the Soup Kitchen tonight, but if you don't know about it, it's a great place. They often serve breakfast, they always serve lunch, and they have a special meal program for seniors in Willimantic. So it's a great cause, fantastic program, and every year we have a reading, a benefit reading for them. So I'd like to invite all of you to make a donation after the reading. You can find me or Lauren, and every penny, of course, counts right now. So it's such a privilege to introduce Tara Betts. I am called upon to introduce the most amazing writers at UConn, and it's such a privilege. So I really want to get to the reading, so I'm not going to dwell too much, but Tara has accomplished a lot. So I'm going to read everything just so you all know where to find her work. I just want to say that I first encountered your work. I can't remember exactly where I first encountered it, but I remember reading a couple of poems of yours in Feminist Wire and just being like, wow. This is someone who's really not afraid to use the powers that they've been given and have cultivated. So in any case, Tara Betts is the author of Break the Habit, 2016, and Arc and Hue, from 2009. She's also one of the co-editors of The Beijing of America, Personal Narratives About Being Mixed Race in the 21st Century, which I'm not, which Sean is also an editor of as well. As well as Kathy Schlein-Biles, correct? Okay. Betts has self-published small runs of several chapbooks, Can I Hang, from 1999, Switch, 2003, Break the Habit, 2012, and Circling Unexpectedly, 2013. Her most recent chapbook, 7x7 Quants of Us, was published by Backbone Press in 2015. Her work has appeared in Poetry, American Poetry Review, Essence Magazine, Nylon, and numerous anthologies. Betts was commissioned by the Peggy Choi Dance Company to write a series of poems and monologues for The Greatest, an homage to Muhammad Ali, in 2011 and 2013. These writings were published on Weep City Press in April 2013 and were mentioned in the New York Times. In 2010, Essence named her as one of their 40 favorite poets. After winning the 1999 Guild Complex's Gwendolyn Brooks Open Mic Award, she represented Chicago twice at the National Poetry Slam in 1999 and 2000. A Kaveh Khanum graduate, she has had residencies from the Raphael Foundation, Centrum, and Caldera, and an Illinois Arts Council Artist Fellowship. She holds a PhD in English from Binghamton University and an MFA in creative writing from New England College. She teaches at the University of Illinois, Chicago. So please, everyone, welcome Tara Betts. Welcome, Tara.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, we should be a little bit of just adjustments.
Okay.
All right. Good. can you hear me nice and clear? All right, good. So, I'm really happy to hear that proceeds from tonight are going to a soup kitchen. This book is dedicated to my mother, and the neighborhood where we grew up, there were a lot of kids that we knew that were friends and didn't always have a place to eat, sometimes not even a place to sleep. And my mom would open the door and be like, you can stay here. There's always food in the refrigerator. There's always a pot on the stove. So to hear that, you know, this program in particular is supporting a soup kitchen means a lot to me to hear that. I'm gonna jump around a little bit, but I'm gonna try to read in order. One of the other things from my childhood that always comes back is my enduring and problematic love for hip hop music. And I always tell people, I wouldn't have the breadth and appreciation of understanding history if it were not for hip hop. And one of those moments was when I first started listening to Public Enemy. So if you grew up anytime in the 90s, you know Public Enemy. You have the hat on, you got on Chuck D's favorite hat. But this poem's called A Lesson from the Terror Dome. Echoes of sirens blared while phrases belted from the boom of Chuck D's voice left imprints sinking into memory that bobs up when buoyant history is necessary. The blast and thump of Welcome to the Terror Dome droned intent with Flavor Flav's clock swinging on his neck, a manic shining searchlight beaming from a black planet that still embodies fear and chaos for some. And when the dancers marched and pivoted in lockstep military formation in front of a target with crosshairs imposed on a black man's silhouette, Chuck D insisted to everyone at earshot, come on down. And the sample's rapid response fired, get down, back. But the internal rhyme in the shooting of Huey Newton never left my head. It sent me, curious, to a small Midwestern library before internet searches streamed into houses. So my finger traced columns in an antiquated guide to periodicals, flipped through a card catalog's long shelves, looked for ends, then Newton, who was he? When I clicked the microfiche onto Spindle and rolled through articles, moving across a white screen, squares of photos and text rolled one frame at a time, until the brief article appeared, Black Panther found dead in Oakland. I shook my head and silently asked, how much of the story is missing? How I wouldn't even know about the bullet dropping Newton if Chuck hadn't told me. For those of you who are graduate students, I'm not too far from where you were. Godspeed, good luck. I did it in this little tiny town, Binghamton, New York, and I remember one day I was coming down the steps and this man was in his truck listening to Rush Limbaugh. So it kind of took this other turn of me hoping for a different future. And I was thinking about that story today with the young girl who was being harassed by her university roommate in Hartford, was her name. And the girl got expelled for like doing unspeakable things to her roommate's property. And I was just like, didn't we like learn this lesson already? But in any case, for those who have not learned to treat people with kindness and respect, I keep thinking that way of life is starting to die because we realize that's not the way to go. And this poem kind of, hearing the guy in the truck, that's where the poem kind of came from. Prophetic fragments. Prophecy is rendered as whole mythic animal. It twists limbs free and open, wide billowing spread of white dragging reams over daylight. People turn their heads, ignore quiet attrition. I mince downstairs with tender ankle and sore foot and lean into a railing with weight a lover never held. There is no easy sweep that foretells what comes. Besides, one day, steady breath stops. I count inhalations as I deliberately deposit weight on each foot. Underneath, a house's foundation crumbles. The water may be poisoned beyond redemption. It runs, wears away rock, cuts down soil, carries wet in small measures. Prophecy announces titles like Liberation, filling my bag with paperbacks and hardcover spines by poets and preachers. Like I did that morning when a man sat in a dust-beaten truck, listening to the pundit yelling about university students touting liberation theology while sitting in living rooms of dangerous radicals. And his truck windows are open and his radio blares. I silently admit truth. I have done all those transgressions, part of a list longer than this diatribe or James Cone's tome in my heavy book bag. He pulls off without looking at me. I lift my bag strap, bring it closer while I walk to the bus stop. We head to different destinations, and both of us will eventually become dust, but prophecy calls, insists the future will fragment the myth that he listens to and expects. Like, I like the yeses, yes, yes. I'm gonna read this for Sean. Not that Sean and I are boobs or anything. I said, do you want me to read you a poem? He's like, you have to read La Guitarra. So I said, okay, I'll read La Guitarra. You know. Now he's gonna crack up. I'm sorry. This book is a lot about losing, and a big chunk of the book is about the dissolution of a marriage. So this is like, when I was trying to write it, I was trying to think of the sweet moments too. So this poem came out of that. La Guitarra. When he was still promising children, you had so many nicknames. A sea of monikers, like colorful glass beads strung together, dipped in jasmine oil. You were cookie, honey, baby, wife, love, beautiful names we all know. But the last name came from his parents' tongue. La, forged in the short song of an article. Then the hard G, pulling the lips back, then falling into Tara, with two hard rolling R's, like bottleneck pressed into frets when chords never relent. La Guitarra. He named your body instrument, shaped like songs uncles plucked from veneer, with long thin neck and narrow waist, set against full chest and wide hips reverberating near his leg. He held you close then, palm pressed on navel, where your strings might be. Then, that was the only lullaby that you would ever need. Then, you know, I'm gonna skip the bitter part. And then there's that part when you start to go, yes, I'm free. And because I love hip hop so much, a lot of people mistake that that's my only musical penchant. So it was really exciting that as I was writing this book, it was like, you know, I'm making references to Hector Lavoe and this particular group that comes up in this one, which is The Cure. Any Cure fans?
Yes. Yes.
For a minute, I felt like I was too old, like nobody knows. And then I'm like finding people who are a lot younger who are like, yes, The Cure rocks. Anyway, this poem's called Love Song. After he left, you bought new headphones with slim silver device that slips into pockets without square buttons, cassettes, or CDs. You build a library of growing sounds, old and new. Add the British girl who taps into ore of women's losses like a prospector. Adele rises brash, full body, telling off the one who walked out foolhardy and soon to regret. You need that rhapsody since you are spending Christmas and coquitos with your girl back from Brazil. She is sun-kissed with Tinkerbell flip-flops. You are meeting her when she lands. On the way to Newark Airport baggage claim, you find yourself alone in a shuttle car, winding around the airport through the quiet night. Her voice, sonorous, almost reminds you of La Lupe, pure sore of Puro Teatro. But it is the song itself that lured you into loving The Cure, and Robert Smith's red lipstick pout and hair sprayed into upright crown and curls. In eighth grade, you kept thinking of his build into the phrase, "Whenever I'm alone with you." You are alone, separated and on this shuttle car. Adele sings this song that permeates more than 20 of your years. It is new again, like the moment when you begin singing to your reflection in the car's window, like a girl with a hairbrush and the perfect mirror to pose. Hands thrown up, pointing, tapping to your chest, eyes closed, this is your concert, a serenade to break tears. You tell yourself, you make me feel like I'm clean again. You make me feel like I'm young again. However far away, however long I stay, whatever words I say, you point at your chest and say, I will always love you. The shuttle stops, doors open, no one enters, doors close. You press repeat and start singing some short triumph again. And you just be like, get out of here. You know? I also have a penchant for blues songs, but I've been thinking about this poem a lot because Glenn Campbell recently passed away, which, you know, again, it's another one, oldie but goodie, but Cassandra Wilson covered that song as well that I'm thinking of in this poem, Wichita Lineman, and I was just like, oh, he passed away, now I'm gonna be thinking about him all the time. Okay, but this is Wichita Lineman, after Cassandra Wilson. When Cassandra opens a cover of Glen Campbell, the eyes I see are dimpled. His arms arc gently under a T of shoulders, slight parentheses, same as his sinewed stance. Why is his body familiar, like decades stacked and popped in one touch, broken in the back of my throat when our lips spoke to each other once so briefly? I know I need him more than want him. I insist that lyric reminisces. Some memory taps pulse into me, like I saw him come home once, like I knew the iron flattening his shirt, like I knew sweat gathered in our kitchen, a hollow trapped at the small of his back, the yolk of him still familiar with a day's sweat, as if he had always known where I stood, how I held up a doorway with my lean, the tilt of head bent, listening to rain tap its staccato long past midnight while it slicks my skin with summer cooling so swiftly. My Wichita line man, still on the line. There will be no dusk in our kitchen, no narrow hum tickling his spine, no clasped limbs in a locket of paired bodies. He is a blues I know, a song caught in the dusk that I avoid singing. Yet I hum, sometimes faintly, conjuring a steady stutter of circuits. So, I am a fan of telling people that body therapy and body work is a lifesaver. So, you know, hence this poem kind of came out, acupuncture. After hair-thin needles slide in above sternum, the hard knot deflates, breaks into chunks, then crumbs that dissolve, I breathe. After ribs rise more slowly, more air enters and leaves the hollow spaces with deliberation. Coughs dissipate. Finally, eyes close, I try to stay still. After daydreams race past the lull of pan flutes that mock the warrior pose in yoga that opens the chest and sweat became a voicemail, there I was, balanced. After one session of sharp silver threads, I could breathe. After two sessions, the flare of heat stopped rising in my chest. A red halo chucked on the highway's shoulder. After three sessions, breath and sleep became quiet. Pounding stopped imitating ball peen hammers and house music. The largest muscle in my chest stopped protesting. After three sessions, tears came harder than all the rain in upstate New York. A knot of grief crumbled. After the last needle was drawn, I knew people could be footnotes or pain. I think this poem matches it. I don't know. I mean, there's some description of domestic violence in this poem, so if anybody's uncomfortable, I just wanted to let you know. But it's a poem for my mother. And it kind of unexpectedly takes turns, very much like the bus in the poem. You're like, what the hell? Why is it doing that? So I used to live where this bus that I would need to take would take me past my house but wouldn't stop. Mm-hmm. So I was like, oh yeah, that's the poem. So, circling unexpectedly. My mother's stories arrive in unexpected stutters, almost like the bus that picks me up after a doctor's appointment. As the bus circles back downtown, it passes my house just so I can take another bus back to where I need to be. Mama, how often have our lives been like that? Recursive, inexact reflections where we see just a little bit of each other. And when I tell you about the sharp throb in my chest that hardens into a knot, you say that my ex did not beat me. My life should be easier. I should know less of the vocabulary of hurt. I was spared a volley of fists. But what if lies are bony knuckles that broadside you? You hear my voice echo yourself. The ache of cold weather in my ankle is the whistle in your limbs. As the bus makes a turn, I remember when you called me after you saw a man beat a woman across Court Street in Kankakee, punching until she fell, a sack of meat and bone, then picking her up to throw her on the blacktop again and again. Your shaking was audible. You called 911. The nightmare of my father is the anvil hanging over you, ready to drop. You never talk about him holding you above his shoulders, a pregnant bale that he threw on the living room carpet. I was the only witness at age 6. We talk about my brothers, how men come and go, work, school, mammograms, acupuncture, travel, a softer utterance of love. We know these lives force us in repeated roundabouts, even as I rewrite the turns. Take shortcuts, go straight ahead, aware of what stands behind us both. So, jump around a little bit. Now I thought about bringing poems that I had online because some of the stuff that's online is much more work. I'm like, dang it, I didn't bring it. I'm happy to talk with you about poems when we finish up here too. And I know I'm talking to a few students tomorrow, so I'm excited about that. But in any case, I'll read a couple more poems. How are we doing with time? All right, so I can do about 2 or 3 poems. A lot of people ask me about the cover. You know, some people are creeped out. I'm like, no, spiders are cool. And I think part of it was, as I was getting towards the end of the book, I didn't know how I wanted to end it. I was like, I don't feel like I'm supposed to be the ending of this book. And since I was so isolated, and again, some of the graduate students may understand this, I saw this spider on my porch. And so since it was outside and it was really, really big, I didn't bring myself to kill it. So I named it. And I started writing about it on Facebook, and people started making up stories about the spider. I called him Craig. So if you've ever seen the Ice Cube movie Fridays, you know, Craig was the name of Ice Cube's character. He always sit on the porch, and I said, this spider's always on the porch, I'll call it Craig. So, in any case, Craig kind of became this anchor of a character and a living thing that I looked forward to seeing every day. And one of my professors was saying, you know, when people are incarcerated, they start to befriend small pests and vermin in their cell because they don't really have outside contact with living things. I said, oh, I gotta get out of here. But, you know, and I also thought about like all the myths too. You think about, you know, Ariadne and and you think about, or is it Arachne? Do I get the names wrong? Arachne. And then I thought about Anansi, and I just started reading about spider behavior. The spiders are so brutal to each other, right? So if we all know what happens to the male spider if he doesn't get the courtship right, right?
Yes.
He gets killed and eaten. And then the women, you know, in most spider relationships. And then, there's some spiders, if they're female spiders, and then the male spider is attracted to them, he will come and tear down her web so that other male spiders can't interact with her. So I was like, oh my God, this sounds brutal like humans are. Okay.
Yeah.
And that poem kind of came out of this. So the drag line is that first line a spider shoots out to establish the web. This poem's called Drag Line. A spider does not differ from other women. Silk unfurls around her, faintly coated in her scent. That draws them. Fills dreams, ripping the lines that frame her limbs in the frame she creates. They watch her ripen into swelled sack of eggs and silk spun around her balanced body until one male studies her lines, symmetry, a growing net flirting in the afternoon sun until he pulls frayed and fragmented strands into flattened strings that catch no wind and clump into hanging rubble. She is not the first woman to lose canvas or poem that came freely. They know she must submit or life stops then and there. And she bundles him in honeyed hormones and death if he fails to pluck the thread of courtship or jump dance just so. Just long enough to spark new lives in her and leave her, to start a new trail of nesting angles beneath nimble limbs, and we believe this is natural. So, I'll do two short poems and close this out. There's one in here I really love because it's more vernacular-ish, and, I wasn't going to read it tonight, but I just feel like you guys seem friendly. I can do this. So another one of the music-oriented poems is kind of inspired by the Bonnie Raitt song, I Can't Make You Love Me. And I kept thinking, I was like, well, if that's the case, then who is this mythological man that, you know, some of us would have to fall in love with? So, and I just was like, so I pictured him playing with all these mythological characters. I can't make him. The man who would make me lay down my heart is myth. He lurks behind the cover of Borges' Imaginary Creatures. I cannot flip pages fast enough to see his face. He gives Bigfoot a pound, winks at the tooth fairy. Last I heard, he could transform into ether, easier to disappear if I ever held him. A gossip rag claims a shield conceals him on a farm populated with unicorns. He plays kickball with Jesus and death. Both are apparently good sports. He speaks Greek and Yoruba to get advice from Zeus and Shango on womanizing. Markers whisper confessions on bathroom stalls and claim he exists, but I have no sleeves where I can pin organs. I refuse to harvest a heart where veins humbly spell welcome in blue. And the last poem I'm going to read tonight is A Golden Shovel. I don't know if you guys have seen the Golden Shovel anthology, but Golden Show was a poetic form popularized, created by Terrence Hayes, where he took the words, of We Real Cool by Gwendolyn Brooks, and they're the words on the right margin of the poem. So if you were to read down this side of the poem, you could read We Real Cool one word at a time. So I took a different Gwendolyn Brooks quote, and I wrote the closing poem in the book. It's called Go. And the line that it borrows from Gwendolyn Brooks is from a poem called Old Mary. And the line was, my last defense is the present tense. It little hurts me now to know I shall not go. So I said, yeah, we get to make choices. Everybody doesn't get to leave. Sometimes we get to go somewhere. So hence, go. If you examine the embers of my life, they will be burned to the last. If anything is worth loving, defense rings its resonant siren. Weaponry is an option that boldly blacksmiths the tender blooming sprout of the present. I seek methods to fortify a steely tense because the heart requires smelting. It wavers in the hungry yellow tongues, little strong licks of heat that echo many hurts. I cannot deny what rocked and kept me, what once made me feel safe, gone now, ashes, dust, burns, singe, blown to a language that wind and soil must know. This wild whisper runs inside me, and I must answer it, or the rustling of skin shall molt what is left. I will not allow myself to live half a life. So I must go. Thank you. She said Q&A, which I'm happy to do. Do you guys need me to get back up here? What are we doing? Or is it easy to see?
I think we're fine.
Yeah. Okay. Or I can at least turn and face you guys. Yes, I can. So, what do you want to do? Do you want to go up there?
Whatever makes you comfortable.
Oh my goodness. Okay. So I'm going to turn the chair around so I can at least look at everybody. Okay. So.
Yeah.
So what you guys think? Questions? Comments? Thoughts? I don't like your poems. Yes.
Actually, for one thing, I love your poem, so I don't think that's a fair way to start. I actually had a question about form, and part of that is because I just came from a talk on form, in like kind of writ large, but thinking along the lines of, because I noticed with Sean, he had the poems in front of him.
Right.
And although I could glimpse them over his shoulder, it occurred to me that I could just hear these kind of formal repetitions without seeing them. And also your love of hip hop, which has a sort of dynamic formalism, which plays and pushes and pulls. Not just musical forms, but also
language. Yes.
Yeah. And I was just wondering if you might be able to say a little bit about the role form plays in your compositional process.
It's funny. I feel like with this book, it was a lot less formal than my first book. But I love teaching and writing sonnets. I enjoy the villanelle. I have a few sestinas. There was a canzone in that book. Quansaba is a 7-line form, and I did a whole little chapbook of those that she mentioned in the beginning, which I like to call them. They're kind of like half sonnets in a way, and they're a little bit less intimidating. So I used to find a lot of short forms, particularly with undergrads, because I'd be like, you can write a short poem, it's a minimal commitment, to be really good at it and master it takes time. But if you're thinking that length is the thing that intimidates you, it's a good window into the form. And I think, too, a lot of writers don't realize how appealing it is to flip through a book and see variety on the page. And I think I was compelled by that
because I like to see a book where it's like they change and transform and do different things. But I also remember early on, I'm trying to think, when did Marilyn Nelson come out with Carver? I'm
sure that was 2003.
Yeah, around the time that came out, I think going into my second summer at Cave Canem, and she was on the faculty there as well. I kind of saw these containers for different voices and historic content in a way that I didn't before, you know, and I felt like this is going to happen more and more. And sure enough, I feel like Marilyn kind of kicked off a wave of that, particularly with African American poets, where they're starting to be like, okay, let's do this formal diversity on the page, you know? And I like not just reading that kind of work, it makes you find new language for it, you know? And I always think of Marilyn Hacker. Recently I've been teaching Edie Shockley and Vanessa Smith, who Don't Call Us Dead, because a lot of people don't even see the forms in the book, you know, they're there, you know? It's not just playing with the typography and stuff like that. So sometimes it's good just to see what a different type of language you can discover in a form. I think you were talking about before how it's kind of a constraint to make you do something different. And that's why I started doing it, because I was like, I don't want to use these same words to tell the same things I want to talk about. You know, how do you give yourself a different language to approach similar subject matter? So that was a long answer. What do you guys, anybody? No? You're so thoughtful.
I'm gonna ask,
I have a question for Tara, but first I have to explain that when I started reading poetry as a boy, mm-hmm. T.S. Eliot and Ezra Pound were still alive. So the question I want to ask you is, what is the role of tradition in your poetry, and what is the role of tradition in poetry today?
I guess it depends what tradition you come out of, right? I think I came into poetry at an interesting time because my first engagements with poetry were probably Maya Angelou and Asafi Shange. So it's a very different framework from Eliot and who's the other? Pound. You know, the Imagist poets. I came upon them later. And I also worked in a public library. That was my first job. So I got to just pick and choose what I wanted to read, and more often than not, I gravitated toward things that I felt like were similar to the types of stories that I could envision myself telling. And then later, I wanted that challenge of looking at things that were very different from what I wanted to write. And then, you know, by the time I went to Chicago, I was a teenager, I was 18 years old, and I kind of fell into open mics and hip hop and stuff like that, which is another different tradition to me, right? So I think, I keep thinking about this quote from Marilyn Nelson's essay, Owning the Master. She says, tradition is not what we create, it's what we inherit. So I feel like, you know, we're finally in a space, I think, in American literature where we can inherit multiple traditions. And I think that's the thing that really drives and informs my work. Like, if I want to write a sonnet, I can do that. If I want to borrow from the modernists, I can do that, you know? And it's kind of exciting to me. I think it's going to make language do different things, and it already is. So I don't know if that answers.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, thank you.
So that was following up on that. I've just started writing some poetry myself because coming out that way.
Right.
And I don't have a style. I have a variety of styles. I'm mm-hmm. challenged to do a slam style. I'm challenged to do a performance poetry. Mm-hmm. So it sounds like that's just what you said. Right? Mm-hmm. The tradition is out there, but you can make anything, any new tradition you want within that. Mm-hmm. Is that what you're...
Or that we have multiple traditions that influence us at once. Mm-hmm. We just have, I think canonically speaking, we've said there's all these divisions. right? Like, these are the ones that are the classics. These are the ones that are important. But it's like, no, there's really multiple places we come from, right? And then even being a woman, you know, you understand what the, you know, they, we may reference Eliot and Pound, but what about HD? We aren't even talking about, you know, and she's phenomenal. So if you think about it that way, it's like, are you thinking about all these multiple streams coming in at once and how much that is impactful, you know? And that sometimes they're equal in their influence. Yeah.
Well, I guess to follow up that, as far as like your creative process now and writers now, and you talk a lot about like hip hop, are there any modern like hip hop people that whenever you listen to the music, you're like, yes, this person would write? Like, and if there are, then I mean, because I know the Public Enemy and Kendrick Lamar are very different, but that's like, I guess my generation is the people behind me or Kendrick Lamar before.
Yeah. So. I definitely like Kendrick Lamar. I love how he uses epistrophe. I love how he uses rhyme. I love how he uses allusions. He's just really dense. I think some people need to catch up. I really love Vic Mensa right now. I was just telling Sean that that's the autobiography is on my current rotation. I love The Roots. I think Black Thought is one of the greatest American poets we could ask for. And the way he can just link and improvise is really exemplary of the genre. But, you know, I think that's also starting to change too in terms of how are we looking at hip hop as a poetic form. You know, you think about Adam Bradley's book, The Book of Rhymes, and he starts to talk about that. But I think there's more to come in terms of people analyzing it and thinking about it. Now, do I think there's some people who's like they are abusing the language? Yes, but that's a whole other discussion. There's a young lady in the back.
You mentioned that you need to do like open mics in Chicago.
Yes.
And I was wondering if you've noticed any change in how you used to write for performance versus like writing for the page, because I know for me, being a performance poet, I feel a large difference depending on what I know my audience is going to be, whether it be a reader or a listener. And I was curious about how you saw that dynamic change, or if you did at all.
You know, I used to go out a lot more. Now I don't go out as much because I feel like it's becoming more of an interior process for me again, which is how it was kind of when I was in my adolescence. I feel like I very much was like trying to process things in my head and put it down on paper. And then being in open mics and things like that, it was more so for me about the community, but it did enable me to read an audience better. Like, you would start to look at your poems and go, I don't think this one's gonna work. Maybe I'm gonna have to try something else. And then I found that once I got more comfortable, I knew certain things I could do in terms of connecting with an audience, where I could even just read out of my journal. Sometimes I would read new stuff that I had written just a couple days before and be like, I can do this. But it took me a long time to build up to that. And I think sometimes, I think that the Academy kind of looks down on the open mic scene and slam still at this point, but I think if we look at how many slam poets who have kind of come, you know, traversed from one scene to the other, that's really a big mistake. Because they're starting to, in my opinion, not just go into the academic realm, but they know how to build an audience. And they're mastering all the same stuff that you go and learn in graduate school. So it's not like, and they get people to engage with them. You know, which I think now in this particular forum, I mean, even not just in the open mic scene, but what you can do online in terms of reaching the audience has really changed it. Now, do I think sometimes it's tilted more toward young people? Yes. And I'm not a young person anymore. When I did it, it was almost 20 years ago. So I think about that now and how it's really great if you're a young poet and helping you build community and meet new people. But I hope that that ageist factor shifts a little bit. Because the other thing that people leave out of that equation is when I started most of the poets that I knew were at least 10 years older than me. And some of them were, you know, like seniors. Like, I think about Kent Forman, who I think he's got a couple poems in Spoken Word Revolution or something like that. And he was probably at least in his 60s. And he was still coming out to slams. And he was somebody who influenced a lot of poets, whether you think of Tyma Jess, Reggie Gibson, myself. I can't even name all other people. But we went to him and visited him, and his daughter is a scholar who studied with Barbara Christian. So I'm just like, those connections, we kind of miss those if we just stay in our little comfort zone. I hope that gets to the heart of some of the things. But it is really good in helping build an audience and learn how to read people and their responses.
You mentioned hip-hop connection to your poetry a lot. And what are the characteristics of hip-hop that relate to writing poetry?
Well, for
about lyrics, basically?
Lyrics, like in terms of, I used to like a lot of the references that were in it, a lot of stuff that was written in heroic couplets, when you really look at it, the way they play with internal rhyme, alliteration, assonance, I love all of that stuff. But I also feel like, particularly when I look at people like Public Enemy, I have more of a narrative sensibility because I grew up in what now people are calling the golden era of hip hop, which was in the 90s. So if you look at that, a lot of that was really heavy on storytelling, and a lot of hip hop that's out now is very much based on, I don't want to say the punchline, but it's looking at how dense your frame of references are. So it's shifted from telling a story to doing these imagistic impressions a lot. And then they still rhyme. Unless, of course, it's mumble rap, which is a whole other thing. And I'm not a huge fan of mumble rap. I hope any of you are. Don't feel offended. But it's like literally they aren't saying words. They're like, I'm like, no, I'm too old for this. You know?
It's like scat singing.
Right, which I'm like, and then they kind of eschew, a lot of people who are into mumble rap are eschewing all these former generations of artists, and some of them don't know anybody. And I'm like, no, whatever art craft you practice, you should know your precursors. Mm-hmm. So I'm just like, wanting to make faces at them, very good. In any case, you know, I think the storytelling, and then looking at too, because I'm so deeply interested in African American literature, how does it continue some of the base of that tradition, right? Does it look at storytelling? Does it look at hyperbolic characters like Stag Lee, or you think of these epic scenes like you might see in a Gene Toomer's Cain, and a story can do, a song can do that. You know, it's just how rich does the performer and the songwriter make it, right? So I find myself thinking about those kinds of things as well with any type of music I listen to. But anybody else? Yeah.
You mentioned Marilyn and Caballano, and I'm wondering, you know, what else you can tell us about
Kamikano? Yeah, Kamikano is a workshop and a writing for African American poets. It was started by Toy Derricott and Cornelius Eady. The name came from this little tile in Pompeii where they had the dog, and it means beware of the dog. But initially, I think they had it in Mount Esopus in upstate New York. And that was where they did the first retreats. And then they moved to Detroit, and it was at this school called Cranbrook. So if you've ever seen 8 Mile, they make a passing reference to Cranbrook. It's like a little prep school nestled just along Detroit. And so that was where I first went to Kamikano in 2002. And then I went in 03. And then in 05, I think they moved it to Pittsburgh. So that's where they're based now, or like close to, it might be Greensburg or something like that, I can't remember. But it's been a very much kind of like a community were black poets from all over the country, and some of them from other countries now. Like I think about poets like Malaika Booker and Nick Nkoa, who are from London, excellent poets, and they've joined the community, Caribbean writers now too as well. So it's been kind of fascinating to watch it grow and expand. They've been doing anthologies. And also they have readings and events a lot in New York City. But the thing that's been really helpful for me is to just be a part of this network and this community of writers who, they get the references, they understand the voice without having to explicate everything and suss it out in certain ways. And it made it much easier for me, before I went to an MFA program, to explain the craft elements of the work. Because I wasn't thinking about how do I explain my experience to somebody, I was thinking about how do I explain my process to someone, which is a very different kind of question, right? Like, how do you write it as opposed to the content? Mm-hmm. And I think good writers, you end up, even if it's something that's very different from your own experience, you go, wait a second, let me look this up. I don't know what this is. And there's a lot of people who really don't do that. Or they just gravitate toward poems that kind of explain their own experience, right? And I always think about Lucille Clifton used to always talk about, as readers, we need windows and mirrors. Windows to help you see the outside world that's outside of your own experience, but mirrors because you need to see stories that reflect yourself. And I really take that seriously when I sit down and write and when I read. I don't want to just see stuff about me, I want to see things that kind of expand what I know is out in the world. So, anybody else? Yes, this young man in the back.
You talk a lot about being influenced by music, like hip hop, but also Glen Campbell, and some other, The Cure. I actually don't know who The Cure is, but.
Google them, it'll be fun.
No, I don't.
They have a greatest hits album. I say get the greatest hits, and then she's prepared to feel like it's a little spooky and weird.
So are you influenced more by the lyrics or by the, like, the melodies and the harmonies? Because, like, as a music writer, like, sometimes I find myself humming along to a melody and then being like, oh, I could use this as, like, a rhythm for a...
I think that's an interesting question, because sometimes it is the twang or those sonic qualities in the song that make you go, wait, what is this? Where are we going? Right? And then other times it is the lyrical content that makes you go, what? And you're asking with this curiosity that you can't quite articulate until you hear it, maybe you listen to it a few times. Sometimes I think it's one or the other, sometimes it's both. But I also tend to tie to memory a lot. Like, I may think about when's the last time I heard it, when's the first time I heard it. I can still remember the first time I heard Wu-Tang's Method Man from Andrew the 36 Chambers, which might have been before some of you were born. But when I think about it that way, but I can also think about, you know, being in my grandfather's car and him playing Bobby Dylan, where I think about, you know, like we have, it's almost like, you know, a lot of writing workshops will tell you to focus on smell because smell triggers so much about memory. For me, music triggers a lot with memory. So if I'm listening to a song, especially if it's one that has that kind of emotional resonance or like a historical resonance for me, then I start tapping into that and tying all those elements together. You know, and it happens in really unexpected ways, I think. Like, I have my graduate students, I gave them this assignment. Has anybody heard of this website, whosampled.com? Mm-hmm. It's like one of my favorite websites. So what they do is they'll take a recent song and then they show you what it sampled, and they'll cue it up so you can hit the video and get the exact moment of the sample.
Oh, that's great.
So I told them, I said, I want you to listen to a song of your choice, and then you take the song that it's sampled, I want you to write some descriptions of both songs. But then you have to think about how do they both tie into this memory somehow? Like, so maybe you describe the sample and how it sounds, how does it loop into the new song, or how does the old song loop into the new song? And then figure out how does it braid itself into your memory? Like, did you hear it the first time you broke up with someone? Did you hear it when your mom was making dinner? And write that poem. It's a very different kind of way to write the poem, because it's not just, you know, I feel like some people, they write the poem where it's like, they want to be like Lou Reed or something, and then they talk about, you know, getting drunk and passing out in the bathroom. That's not an exciting poem all the time. It really isn't. It really sounds like a romantic kind of excitement. But it's like when you start thinking about those moments from your life you carry with you, and how does music act like the canoe to carry that moment? It's a very interesting kind of thing. Does that answer your question?
Sure.
I think I jumped around a lot. But I think it can be either the sound of the song or the lyrical content, and sometimes it's both. Thank you.
Thank you, Tara.
Thank you so much. Carrier to sign them if you'd like. In the meantime, right,